It's Valentine's Day, and this is Lecture 38 on Test Driving a Tesla and the Razor's Edge for New Green Products. So in this picture, you see an electric vehicle Tesla, one of the hot new California companies, and there is this electric vehicle. You see it's recharging, I believe. And look at that sticker price, $109,000 for this car. That's aggressively priced. That's a little more than what I paid for my Toyota Avalon. Is it a good deal to purchase this new green product at that price? Consumers don't have a long-run consumer reports that they can look at to know this product's quality. What is the product of a Tesla? There's a lot of buzz about this company, but what's the truth? It's still being discovered. So that brings us to today's debate between two important guys. On the left is a prominent New York Times reporter, John Broder, who often writes about climate change issues. And on the right is Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla Automotives. And they're having a disagreement about the quality of Tesla electric vehicles. So Broder started this a couple of days ago, and you can see this New York Times reference there, when he wrote a pretty negative review about the Tesla, and I'm sure he knew he was writing a controversial piece. And Tesla and its fans have been strong in replying to this New York Times review. So this is sort of a battle of the buzz. The New York Times is a famous newspaper. Tesla is a well-known new product. And there's a debate going on whether at $109,000 for the typical car, for the typical Tesla, is this a good deal? Now, I can't answer that, but as an economist, I want to talk about a different issue. We have seen past green products, the most famous examples, the Toyota Prius, win the competition. So a couple of years ago, the hybrid vehicles were the green vehicles. Honda Civic had a hybrid vehicle. The Prius had one. Toyota's Prius was one. And we know that Toyota won that fight, that marketing fight, that everyone in Berkeley who wants a hybrid is most likely to purchase a Prius as their car. A very interesting question at the intersection of sociology, psychology, and economics is, what did Toyota do right to win that fight? Did it simply produce the best car and sell it at a reasonable price? Or did it win some public relations fight in sort of the battle of the buzz? And so in the second bullet point, I'm asking a philosophical question. How razor's edge was Toyota's victory? Had things gone just a little bit differently? Had Honda Civic had a flashier, sexier advertising campaign? If Toyota's shape for the Prius had been a little bit different, would they have had a much lower market share? If the answer is yes, then in some sense, Toyota's victory was razor's edge. If somebody early on with the Prius had written a negative review about the product, could that one single review have torpedoed the Prius? A story for when that could be the case is a model of herding, if one person hears that a restaurant is bad, then they don't go, and they tell their friends that it's bad, and then their friends don't go, sort of setting off a chain reaction. When it was just one person's opinion the first time around, but he told two friends who told two friends, and all of a sudden you have an infinite number of people with strong views on a product that they've never actually consumed because I heard from a friend what the friend thought. And I think part of Elon Musk's concern as CEO of Tesla is that he believes the herding theory, and it would very much help his sales and his ability to collect $109,000 per car if people actually had a strong initial opinion about these cars, that it's worth the money. But Broder's New York Times review is a bit of a punch in the groin by a skeptic that maybe it is overpriced. And as a businessman and as a profit maximizer, Musk has strong incentives to counter this. So by robustness, I mean the following thought experiment. If a capitalist firm produces an excellent product, will that product underperform in the long run? If you make the best cheeseburger in Los Angeles, can it be that forever nobody discovers you? But because Paris Hilton went to your competitor's burger place, that lucky place got a reputation for excellence, even though it wasn't deserved, and they became the next In-N-Out burger, well, your place, just because economists somehow wandered in there for the first meal, and your place generated no buzz, that your place doesn't succeed. I don't believe that. Yes, luck matters in this life, but I'm a believer that with excellence, you can overcome unlucky initial conditions and get the market share you deserve. So in the case of the green economy, there's many electric vehicle competitors out there. Which one is great? Is image everything? I would argue that an unintended consequence of Broder's piece is that Tesla now has an incentive to produce an even better product because they recognize that their image has taken a punch and they need to offset that with a higher quality product if they intend to continue to sell those cars at $109,000 each. At the end of the day, the green economy is going to take off, whether it's solar panels, energy efficiency, due to the quality of these products, not the hype. And so I think Tesla should thank Broder in the long run.